Dakika. Ապեր գնոպկե քի բանը չի ինգեր ստեղ ես երկոտ պետլիշկ է բանարը դրե հետպետ պարկմանիշների Ախպեր ուչկ են որ բրնում են տակը երկոտ գնոպկե Ապեր ջնջած ավրի բաներ ապեր դրա համար չեմ ուզում այլ բան սեղմեմ ինգեր ուշկի տակը Միատ սրա բանը անջատ է կել ես վրի բանը տաբլում, դիսպլեյ է, որ դու ծայքի։
Կես հիշում եմ բուրերը որ տեղեք։
Տվեքից միատ խաբար առա դիսպլեյ է անջատ է մել, նեզ բան չան ես անգով։ Տակ։ Այս արդեն զվուկը զգնում է բան, այս արդեն զվուկը սետում է բանի մեջ, վիդյոյի մեջ, տեսը։ Լսար թե վիդյոյի մեջ չս։ Չեք պետ չէ, այն վլա։ Այն զվուկը սեկը։ Սրդա խորոշում մեսը ծուժը։
1 2 3 4
Եվ այսպես մենք սկսում ենք մեր էքսկուրսիան դեպի ինտերնետի աշխարհ։ Նորմալա։
Էսը ու՞մ է հայերը։
վաժը դե ինքը հա միացրած է
միացրած
հա
սիրսերը լույս մուշ չի վառում
լույս թուլ վարձում է ինձ նայ էս կողքը
կարծում
ռեգուլատորը հա
հետ ուզես մի տեսա դե նայ
Ես էլ իմ կոմբը միացնեմ արագ-արագ սարկելի մասնակիցներ ինչպես ինչպես է ձեր դրամատրությունը լավ ճաշեցիք Good afternoon, dear colleagues. My apologies for the technical interruption. We are starting the last parallel session of the forum for today, which is entitled Electronic Tools for the Electronic Society, or E-Tools for E-Society. So the discussion of the topic will be attended by our colleagues, who I will introduce. The speakers, today will be Mr. Ali Al-Meshal, who represents the internet community, NGO from Bahrain. Mr. Arman Atoyan, the founding director of XTech Company, Armen Manukyan, founding director of Masis Company, Sir Vahagan Boghossyan will be participating too, for representing the Instigate Company, and Mr. Armen Nazarjan, who is representing the Armenian Internet Community. Also, the minutes will be taken by Anna Karakhanyan, Mrs. Anna Karakhanyan from the member board, the member board of the Armenian Internet Community. So I will be facilitating. I'm Mr. Artur Tunyan, and I will be facilitating this session. I will replace Artur Tunyan because he couldn't attend, so I'm Hayk Chobanyan. So please participate actively and raise your hands or make a gesture, and I will ask you to take the floor after each of the speakers make their presentations. So then there will be an opportunity for you to express your viewpoints, your perspective. So ask me and I will allow you to speak. So the use of e-tools is one of the most important elements of the society, or putting it in a different way, electronic society or digital society. So that's the most general way to provide a description of the difference of the modern world from the world 50 years ago. So our modern time coincides with the beginning of the 21st century.
And our
age needs huge transformation, constituting great challenges for us. So the e-society or the digital society is a complex phenomenon. It exists in different corners of the world. The developed countries have already achieved great progress in this area, and it looks like there isn't much to do for us but repeat or duplicate or reproduce what has already been achieved by the developed countries. However, the changes that given the changes that have taken place in this area, there are still big disparities that need to be handled. So speaking about the e-tools of the society, in Armenia, I would specify four basic elements of electronic services. The first one being the electronic registers or electronic databases. The second one is the internet itself, or the telecommunications, or internet, so the bands that provide, that ensure the work of the internet, and then two more elements which help with the identification and authentication of individuals. So these two constitute the identification system for the citizens and also the system of the electronic signatures, which is one of the most common tools for identification of humans. This should also be the basis for the future identification of humans, and also the basis of e-governance. So currently, one of the major challenges that we face is the safety to applied when obtaining and retrieving information. So all of us have headaches, difficulties related with the security measures. It's obvious that in the developing digitized world, we could say that currently we have no solution which might be unified, a consistent solution for the whole world. This is the biggest challenge for us, whether we are speaking about the electronic signature or biometric descriptors. So the path of development will show us, the development of innovation will show us what the future will bring. So these are some types of services available in the Republic of Armenia. The Unified e-Governance Portal. Another service is the electronic cadastre service or the service for registering real estate in the country. Recently, considerable changes took place, and I think that all of us can feel that in our daily life. So another service is the registration of vehicles. We know that we have achieved, we are rather advanced in this area. And then in the banking system, we have the e-invoicing and the banking system. There are also electronic educational systems. Today we have a school management information system, and we also have a VT and higher educational institutions or management system. So these are the two information registers of the education system, so the VET and the university. So at the same time, we need to mention the private initiatives. The most common among these and the best established among these in Armenia are the electronic banking systems. All of the banks actually provide electronic internet banking services. There are three banks in Armenia which already provide not only mobile bank services but also mobile paying systems. So Commerce Bank was the leader in this area. So typically, they are using a local product developed by a company called Boomerang Software. So this is a payment, electronic payment system. And I could use this example to tell you that one of the most requirements for the implementation of these systems is the use of the internal, of the domestic expertise and resources to develop this area. And this development is taking place quite successfully in Armenia, both in terms of content and innovation. So in the digital industry, I would like to emphasize a few things. First thing being the competitiveness. So actually, this is a revolution in economy. The company, a business which is using digital technologies, is enhancing the competitiveness, starting with the use of internet marketing system, marketing tools, and the use of the internet, digital solutions. So through these different processes are automated, and this also helps reduce the production costs. The second item is the development. Digital solutions are tools for development of any economy, and we cannot imagine any branch of any sector of the economy without digital tools. So effectiveness or efficiency is the third element, the third item. I'll give you an example. So this is related with e-commerce, which was a huge revolution over the recent years. The countries which work in this area, they achieve successes which wouldn't be possible without the use of electronic tools. For example, the Amazon company has increased their sales volumes immensely. So in any business that success could have been deemed impossible. Development of promotion of new businesses. Yes, I will repeat that these new businesses are again related to e-commerce. It's very interesting that that the use of digital technologies expands the outsourcing services, and so this allows different services to develop. This is on the whole a positive phenomenon, because the number of professional companies is growing, and this trend can be observed in Armenia as well. And we know that the most common services are consultancy services and accounting services, and we know that these are already possible through digital electronic tools like digital banking, internet banking, etc. Another item is new jobs. Yes, and this is true. Currently, there are many new jobs which truly emerged due to digital technologies, to digital tools. And so we call this an important component for any new profession. So, I mean, command of digital tools, computer literacy. So, new possibilities. So, now this is happening every day, be it the television, the schools, the universities, or private initiatives, or electronic education, which constitutes part of the electronic economy and the electronic society, and on the other hand, electronic education or online education is one of the most rapidly developing sector in this education sector. And digital innovation. So this is the important prerequisite for ensuring our future in various terms, and we need to be able to prioritize this component in our development programs, in our principles, etc. Is there any technician here? I think. Now, I want to speak about the Armenia's economic potential, and also speak about how digital economy or digital society can promote the development of digital tools and technologies. Today we are facing an issue. We have set ourselves a task to be one of the 10 most innovative countries in the world by the year 2020. So I already mentioned that digital technologies are a vehicle of development and a criterion for competitiveness. So if we want to have a leading role in the economy, then innovation should be our first priority. I will say that currently are in the 53rd country among the innovative countries in the world. We have developed an Armenian technological brand aimed at innovation. So it is based on innovation. And our aim is, or our goal is, to achieve a situation where our country is becomes a platform for finding and developing digital solutions and then later exporting these solutions. So, within this framework, we try to understand the potential and the expertise available in Armenia for the implementation of e-services and digital technologies being components of such services. There are tens of companies in Armenia who have participated in and implemented projects both in Armenia and overseas. So the goal of the project is to, through collaboration, to create a cluster which would offer a comprehensive solution for the implementation of any electronic system in Armenia, and on the one hand, this cluster would be a means for developing export, and on the other hand, this cluster will be a basic pillar for the development of domestic services. So our goal is to engage all of the companies that work in this sector and to achieve an absolute consolidation by the local companies, so that the tools created in Armenia would become the basis for the development of Armenia's economy, and all the knowledge obtained and accumulated during the development of these tools, I mean the know-how and the innovation, so to keep all of these in country for expansion within the country, and then the financial output should also be kept in the country and circulated in order to enhance development of the technological sector. So the digital economy and the digital solutions are mutually promoting the development. So our goal should be to connect these two together and to connect the application with the practical areas of the economy. Now colleagues will speak about the technical solutions, but I will end my presentation with this. And just then that we have three tools. Well, the first thing is the branding, so we need to brand this product. The second is that we have serious work to do. So we know that prioritizing the local solutions is an important thing, and it should also be enshrined in strategy documents. And also there should be public and private support in this area. I will ask Armen Manukyan to continue, to take over, because he can give you more details about the technical aspects of the platform, which has already been developed, and then we will continue. So good afternoon, dear friends. So I'm Armen Manukyan, head of Masis company. So the key idea is that we are creating an e-governance consortium, e-Governminya consortium, which aims to create an innovation, to convert Armenia into an innovation platform, to convert Armenia into a place where the innovation and new knowledge will become material in this soil, and then it will be exported or expanded into the other parts of the world. So our technologies, our breath, and spreading our technologies, our souls, our breath, and communicating them with the most countries of the world. So that's the main concept. So we have two roads to follow. The first one would be not to be a leader, not to lead, but follow and limp behind other countries which are making some innovations. And so we think that we are not capable of doing anything to show the world. So this would mean, once again, running after others and implementing things invented by the others. And then in this case, then we should ask ourselves, why are we a state? So if we are a state, equal to the others, and the other states are solving problems and they are showing paths of development to the world, but if we cannot show roads of development to the world, then perhaps we could just enclose ourselves and become isolated. And the great philosophers always emphasized that the important thing is to find and show paths of development to the world, to the other countries. At one time, there were big transitions during history, like the transition or the development from cuneiform writing to, and then the humanity developed, and then the humans invented these printing machines, and this had a huge impact on the development of the whole mankind, or the internal combustion engine. This was another revolution. When the internal combustion engine was invented, it was the basis for the French Revolution, for banking systems. And now, so similarly, today it is the era of information technologies, and our country is facing these challenges and these issues. So, like I said, we can either be an innovative country and identify new roads for the world, or not to do such things. All of us know that Armenia has a great potential, and over the millennia, Armenia manifested, displayed, or demonstrated that Armenia is a country where ideas are generated, which provide a huge impulse to the rest of the humanity. So there are many examples. So today we are facing this challenge. So I mentioned two roads, and if we follow the second road, that of innovation and development, then Armenia will become a platform for development and innovation. So you heard about citizen data science. This is a big trend that is being developed, or single sign, or identity management. So, and this is used when humans have to, well, people have to access some certain systems and use specific functions. So so many people in the world are sitting and trying to thinking and trying to find solutions. So in this context, Armenia has a possibility to outsource its potential. So Armenia exports it, the ideas, and they are patented, but they are not patented as an Armenian product, but for example, as a California brand. So we were, but these products are not, do not have the writing made in Armenia. They say made in California. But what's important is that to create innovations and then brand them as Armenian products. So to make the world know that these are made in Armenia. So first we should materialize these ideas in our laboratory and then disseminate them or spread them to the rest of the humanity. Or we can make a gift. We can say, dear people, take them and use them, enjoy them. So because this has been happening for centuries, things, well, innovations being made here and then spreading and being enjoyed by others. When different ideas are being discussed freely, we could so we know that if we use the pyramid-like format of discussions, then that wouldn't allow no innovation. So we should work in an harmonious environment where there will be no sharp corners, and in that case we can have generate great innovations and then export them into the world. So I tried to present, to formulate somehow the ideas, the situation. I think that this is one of the most important issues for our country, for our state, and for the meaning of the existence of the state. Thank you, Mr. Manukyan. I want to ask Mr. Ali Almeshal with a question, to answer the following question. So far, what was his attitude? Not as a consumer, but as a creator, as a maker. So let's look at digital development not as consumers, but as producers, because these are important for the whole world and for specific countries in particular. So my question was as follows. To what extent is it realistic? Does it look realistic to you that any country, specifically Armenia, should look at digital development not as a consumer, I mean, to consume and use the goods, the electronic goods, digital goods created in the world, but becoming a producer and contributing to the development of these innovations. Շնորհակալություն։ Ընդհանուր առմամբ, ինչպես գիտեք, թվային բիզնեսը եւ կամ այդ թվային բումը, այդ բուրն զարգացումը թվային տեխնոլոգիաների, մենք ասում ենք թվային բիզնես.
So these countries or entities would be left back, and this had a major impact on the economy. Just highlighting things about the payment instrument, which is one part of the digital economy, which is the payment part of it. So it's not only Armenia, it's the whole economy, it's the whole world. Whoever is not coping with these changes, whoever is not moving ahead with the digitizing the say the business itself. When I said e-business, e-business is covering everything, it's not the only payment. So they will be left back, and they will not be able to cope with the, speaking on the level of the country, not even the level of the individuals. While the individuals are maybe more advanced than the country because they are practicing the digital itself by themselves when it comes to the going on the payments part or any other, like going on the mobile things, that they are moving from the normal, let's say, is brick and mortar things to the e-economy and e-digital or e-business. Thank you.
Շնորհակալություն այստեղ մեկ մարտահրավերել կա։
Thank you.
But
actually there is another challenge here. So the world is not developing evenly in terms of application of digital technologies. The objective reason is that people are not quite developed in digital literacy. So what I mean is that the mechanisms for introduction of digital literacy are not adequate. And the greater part of the society, at least in this country, is still far from being called an e-society. There are also subjective reasons here, which are related to rather to the force of habit or other factors like indifference or others. So I would like to ask Mr. Arman Atoyan, who is the company he created, he founded, is creating tools for the e-society, and I would like to ask him to speak about the issues and problems related to the dissemination of these tools and the making of these tools more effective. Thank you. Arman Atoyan, founding director of XTech company. So it was already spoken about the components of the society that the government owns and uses, like creating the system for vehicle plate numbers, etc. So personally, I was involved in the creation of this project, and I would suggest that we evolve the discussion here, and I would encourage your participation to participate and to come up with ideas and recommendations. So let's look at the specific concrete projects. In 2001, this portal, SAS-AM, was created in Armenia, and I was involved in it, which was the greatest e-portal functioning in Armenia. But the thing is that different officials and individuals or businesses are trying to find a similar solution, but they fail. We know that e-portal, having an e-portal is important for the development of your business. You know, there are many goods in Armenia which are quite fit for export from Armenia, but it is difficult to do that without internet portals. However, we had this successful example, and but this was a specific, a standalone example, while others still have these problems. And I'm not sure if anyone is dealing with this issue on the government level, or this is just talk. So this was a big task to digitize 30,000 types of goods and to create this content. The importance was that so there was already a component, part of the e-society, who wanted to do shoppings online and not to have to go to shop, or people living overseas could do shoppings for their relatives who live in Armenia. Most importantly, there is the lack of electronic payment systems is a big issue, especially the PayPal not supporting Armenia yet. So this is another initiative where, as my colleague said, so this is a tool made in Armenia but used elsewhere. So we want to, well, this project was a winner of international competitions, and we want to export this project. So we, I wouldn't say that this is a product of a genius, but it is a well-developed project which has no precedent in even developed European countries. So the problem that we had here was the raising the awareness of the public. So even if we had some useful content, we had no means for raising the awareness of the public. So the company needed to do this through their own resources, even if it was a social project. So many people are not even aware that there is such a project, such a portal where people can report their issues, and their issues will be sent to the city hall, and the city hall or the municipality will provide issues to their questions or problems. So some type of mechanism needs to be created to make people aware that there are projects which are useful and helpful for them. Perhaps this much about this project. And the next practical project is called a Mobi Taxi. This works very well. You can order a taxi by a mobile app, so you won't have to telephone the operators or the these taxi services, the dispatchers. So you can simply call from your app, and the taxi will approach your home, and you can use it. Another serious hindrance is that the lack of an e-payment system. If this were possible to be integrated, people would pay for the taxi with their cards through the mobile app. It's possible, possibly the project will be spread in other countries as well. Like there is a service called Uber, and which is not very common. So many tourists ask this question. They say, why can't I pay electronically, not to have to pay in cash? So this is another issue that I'm not sure how long, how many decades will be discussed without a final solution. Another issue is that access to devices by the people. There are many people who own an iPhone 6, and they are looking forward to the issue of iPhone 7. However, they have no idea. These people have no idea about GIS. So, but perhaps little by little, this will be handled. Another innovative initiative is our startup created based on innovative technologies, which allows to animate any printed image. So when you hold it on any image, it will become an animation. You can't have believe this. I will show you. So, for example, this is a book about dinosaurs, and for the kids, this is a children's book. We know that today we have a big issue. The children don't read anymore, but kids are using tablets, and smartphones. So here we are trying to find a way to make these iPads useful for the kids. So the kids not only play with the iPads, but they can use them to read books, to make the books interesting for them. I could say that the challenges here are about the same as those that I mentioned about mobile text, that they can download the app from the iPhone, from the iStore, iPhone Store, or Apple Store, and many people do not know about it, but I'm not talking about everyone, but I'm just listing the problems. So perhaps this much about the tools that we have created, and because all of these projects are cross-cutting issues with the tools to be created for the e-society. If you have questions, I will be happy to answer them. To speak the truth, you are already competitor to Digitaxi. Yeah, actually, Digitaxi already existed when we were commissioned to create this Mobi Taxi. So we wanted to know what was it that was lacking in Digitaxi. Now, an important difference is that when you open this app, you already see immediately whether there are free vehicles in the neighborhood or not. You can see it on the map, and you can make up your mind about ordering that taxi or not. But in the other app, you order the vehicle. Maybe there may be 100 free cars, but not in your neighborhood. And the other functions of the Digitaxi app are just serving administrative purposes. So, and I will repeat that the other serious issue is the electronic payment system, which is non-existent, but it should be created. Thank you, Mr. Atoyan. So actually, we get the impression that the situation in Armenia looks like this, that the supply exceeds the demand. So we supply the society, the market, and the economy many solutions, but there is no real demand. Perhaps it would have been more natural and more relaxed if the demand existed, the supply. As we are seeking for the reasons, perhaps we can also find some faults. Perhaps we are not doing something things right. You cannot just put all the blame on the society and say, why doesn't the society know these things, or why are they making mistakes? Why are you using the different digital devices or electronic devices that you mentioned? What would you say, Mr. Nazarian? Armen Nazarian. Armen Nazarian, I represent the Internet Society of Armenia. I'm the deputy chairperson. I will start. You know, during the Soviet years, the disabled persons were a community, were useful people. They helped the government. They built the eye clinic named after Malayan. So all of them worked in the government using their own money, built houses and apartments. So they lived full lives. But things changed. Maybe some to some 50 or 100, they give them some basic equipment to use, and the rest are left without any support. So this was a lamentable situation. On the other hand, the information technologies are one of the most important components for their rehabilitation. That's why the internet community started to collaborate or to cooperate with these disabled persons. Actually, this topic is related because tools should be created for the society which would enjoy a demand. I will give you an example. All of us remember that many years ago, we paid 10 or 100 times more for the internet. Not because that internet was most 10 or 100 times more expensive, but because the demand exceeded the supply. And for the same reason, we paid a lot more for the cellular connectivity. So again, for the same reason, the demand exceeded the supply. But now we are offering tools to the society, which the society is not quite ready to accept. So what to do? So we listed internet or digital literacy as one of the reasons. We may also list other reasons. Now you should speak specifically about people with limited abilities. Yeah, currently the disabled persons are in a situation where the most important thing is to take them out of their homes. So this means that we need to create a convenient and favorable environment so that they walked out of their homes and felt as full-fledged members of the society. So community, internet community, was created in 2011. In the goal of this project is to support the exclusive projects. So the this project received investments in the amount of $100,000 from the International Union of Communications, and it was coordinated with the active participation of the president of the community, Igor Mokortomian and Grisha Sarian. Now, this is the Internet Center. This is the photograph of Internet Center on the Sarian 22. So there are computers there. It's fully equipped, and the center started to function. So we conducted several training workshops. In 2011, and things were going normally. Unfortunately, everything is written here about the seminars and the workshops. So I will not stop here. The next slide. Unfortunately, this the center started to have very few visitors, and also the center was located in the main post office building. Then the internet community received a grant in the amount of $10,000 for the creation of this internet center. And then we had this concept of creating a rehabilitation center for blind persons, and also a sport and cultural, and provide social and cultural services. So this is the building. In April 2013, we received the grant to build this center. So everything was prepared. The First Lady was invited, the Minister of Culture, and a great number of people. So the opening, the took place quite successfully. And then the president of the internet community introduced the goals of establishing, founding the center, and everything was going on well. Here you see Mr. Igor Mokortomian. You see the First Lady, the Minister of Culture. So according to this concept, the basement of the and the ground floor, the basement and the ground floor should be used as rehabilitation complexes for the blind, and then for sports. There were also facilities for sports rehabilitation. The problem, well, it was not really a problem, but the thing is that having only one internet center wouldn't work, and you could invite people there to spend 2 or 3 hours a day and then leave. If a person arrives early in the morning and uses the entire set that can be provided, that would have been a different situation. But 2 or 3 hours wouldn't make much difference. So that's the same room. This is the hallway. Then in half a year, the first lady invited Mr. Ara Abrahamian, the head of the Union of Armenians in Russia, who promised to totally to subject the building to capital repair. So on November 13th, 2015 of the current year, it will be the 270th anniversary of a person called Valentina Gawi, and she is the person who started to take care of the blind people and was the first person in the world to do that. So actually, this initiative served as a trigger for services for the blind. The three or four persons and instructors are working in this center. They're making sure that the work goes on normally. Here, I provide a description of what they do. And the internet also started to help in terms of providing sports services. So the showdown and surfing competitions. So these two types of forms of sport are forms both for platforms for the blinds and for the seeing. So now we have applied for another grant for internet radio. So this much, thank you for your attention, but the problems are just starting. Thank you. I would like to continue the topic, our topic where we stopped. Now we will ask a professional who has been working in the area of digital technologies for many years, and we will ask him to complement and to complete everything that was said here. And this is Mr. Arman Bogosyan. Good afternoon. Going back to the topic, I will like to ask once again, why do we need to believe in digital technologies? Soon we will see how the internet changes, how Web3 comes, how things will all be decentralized. And we have also not we have not all yet seen the revolution of the interface between humans and the touch screen devices. So far, looking at what is being done overseas and what is being done here, all of it will become outdated, obsolete very soon. Everything becomes outdated in the world quite rapidly. For these changes, we need to be prepared, and we need to propose our own solutions. I welcome this idea of the consortium. The Armenian companies have their resources as to outsourcing. We are creating solutions for foreign companies, but in these actions, we relate to many serious companies, and we grew in the meantime because we get to know what issues should be emphasized. By consolidating these companies, we can create our own technologies, and based on those technologies, our vertical solutions. I trust very much that this will happen, but this is a two-sided street. On the one hand, the government, which is, but on the other hand, the foreign countries will always set forth requirements and demands that their own companies cannot meet. And so what I mean is that the consortium will be quite efficient, and it will enable us to start a dialogue with the government and set criteria. We cannot purchase solutions from a monster company and then create another monster in the country. We should not forget that all the components created by Igor can be supported and assisted with. So we are dreaming of being one of the 20 most innovative countries in the world. So this is not just a dream. We are working on solutions for the kindergartens and other practical solutions. But this is the case where the government agencies should also assume, should also commit themselves to the activities. I think that the government should be interested and promote the growth and the development of internal, of domestic solutions, but we really don't anticipate the government to make a lot of effort. What we expect to see is that the government should just turn back and look and see those solutions. So the technologies change, the ages change, and the revolution of that I mentioned, of the Web3 or touch screens. So these are new. These are innovations, but we should create new technologies for the new age. I want to thank all the speakers. We tried to formulate, to specify the key challenges that the IT area of Armenia is facing. It wouldn't be possible to describe all kind of recipes or prescriptions during this short period of time, but I think that we outlined some issues, some areas that should be prioritized. And in the end, I want to ask our guest to take the floor, Mr. Ali Almeshal, if he has anything to add to what was already said. The floor is yours. Շատ շնորհակալություն, ցույց թույլ տվեք ոտքի կանգնել, կներեք որ հայերեն եմ խոսելու։ Դուք էստեղ խոսեցիք մի շարք թեմաների մասին, որոնք բոլորն էլ վերաբերում էին, ասենք այդ թվայնացմանը, վճարման պլատֆորմներին, այլ բաներին։ Ես կուզենամ մի ակնարկ
either an ATM card, debit card, or a credit card, so, or maybe both of them.
So just to give you an idea about the bits and pieces about the risk being in there, so we'll go through the presentation. Please, just move it. You know, in the normal way, when you are using your credit card, you are going to the counter, giving the card to the, let's say, to the staff there, to the cashier, whoever, and he's swiping it, putting it, if it is a chip, asking you to put a pin, if it is a pin and chip, or if it is only pin, and you continue. Either you sign, or it goes, if it is wiped by pin, it goes by itself. Okay. So have you ever think about to look into the specification of the credit card? Is the credit card that you are holding is, I'm just moving you from the face-to-face transaction, from the physical to the E. So I'll take you through this step till we reach to the E business. So these are the credit cards that most of us hold, if it is not all of us. And there are some specific characteristics about that that show you that this card is a genuine card, is not a fake or counterfeit card. You will have, this is normal, the magnetic stripe. And you'll have a code. This comes in different places. I will show you where is it. This is called card verification value. This always used whenever you are doing a business on the internet or when you are purchasing. It's always asking you to enter this code. So always make sure to save this card, this number, not to share it with anybody, because if he has. So if he has that number and he is purchasing from some of the site on the net, he just need the card number and this one, and the transaction will move. On the other hand, we have the Dove or the hologram of Visa or MasterCard. This again, one of the security. It's like the note, the currency that you are having. There is some specification that shows you what is that. We have something called the digits, the four or the six digit of the card. This, from our experience, we have seen a lot of counterfeit cards that start here with four, while the card here is five. What does that mean? All, this is a standard, international standard. All Visa cards start with four, and all MasterCards start with five. So when these fraudsters or hackers doing some counterfeit cards, they put for you here four, which is this is the BIN of the bank, the identification, and while the BIN here is the card number is five. So these are some of them. We can move, please. Here again, showing you in different place, and this is the hologram instead of coming here, coming in different place. Okay. So, and you know that the chip technology came in. I mean, it's not that much far. It is maybe 5 to 6 years to different regions, but guess what? Still in the United States, which is the biggest economy, they are not using this chip. Still, they are depending on the magnetic stripe. They are being forced now, and they have just started last year to migrate their cards to chip. What is chip? Is chip now, as any other SIM card holding, all the sensitive and security information on the card instead of depending on the MAC stripe, because MAC stripe is easy to copy and easy to make a counter duplicate card of that. This is one of them. This is a case that have been taken in Far East, held by the police. All of these cards were ready to be carrier and shift deliver all over the world to start be using. These are all duplicate cards, ready, Visa, Master, American Express, Diner Clubs, whatever, you name it. All of these cars were ready, but just to be shipped, and the fraudster will be just moving from one country to another country just to use the card. Maybe he used the card for one time, use it for two times, until it gets blocked, and then he move around. This is again the same picture, different. See, hundreds of them. And that one was easy to do. This is a machine that cost only maybe $300, $500 maximum. And it imposes all of these type of cards. All what you need is a tool to generate the card number, or somebody is taking these card numbers for you from wherever. You'll just, I'll just mention that later on. And then the fraudsters or the hackers goes on. Now, if you move to the online, to the e-commerce part of it, we don't know the customer, and even the merchant doesn't know us. So the type of the online, we have what we call call center or mail order. We have the e-commerce and we have the mobile commerce. This is one of the most critical ones because the call center or motto, we call it mail order. We normally call the merchant or we call the service provider and we give our credit card to them, the card number. And we give them normally the CVV, the one I show you, which is the security code, for them to enter it and get the transaction done. And that is the biggest risk because we are storing, I mean, the merchant is storing this information on his systems, and later on, he can leak this information to the fraudster, and the fraudster will make that hundreds of cards that was available. So we said the significant increase in the card not a present fraud linked to a compromise of data. This is what we said about the mail order. And then the improved, when the people moved to the security, to the chip and pin, like the whole, most of Europe region, Middle East region, they moved to the chip and pin. So the fraudster couldn't find a way because still the chip and pin, there is not a serious case that have been reported that the card have been duplicated because of the chip. So the fraudsters moved to the online. Online still is a targeted market and easy to move. There are number of research that I have just selected one. It shows that the increase of the fraud and from 2011 to 2013, then to 2018, the percentage and the amount that have been or expected to be, like it, the losses will reach to $6.4 billion. All the losses is coming from the e-commerce. So that's given an indicator that we need to focus, we need to be sure about when we are using which site, which card we are using, and which information we are giving there. As reported by one of the card scheme, when I said card scheme, it means like Visa, Master, or Amex, the losses of them was around $2.8 billion in one of the year because they did not declare that. It was a bit confidential, but I get just this information from them. And that one represents 0.09% of the total business that card scheme done. So, and around $650 is the average of any the average of the card lose that is going on. On the Visa itself, 5 million transactions or 5 million cardholder have done at least one singular transaction. That gives us a lot of indicators. Again, if we are doing any e-commerce business, if we are enabling the e-commerce for any type of business, we have to make sure that all the security things are in place. The worldwide in 2000 as expected to reach 1.7 trillion million of e-commerce transactions. On that side, we have to look into the risk as well. So the international order risk, I mean, you have seen maybe number of sites that whenever you do an order, they do not accept to do an international order. They accept only domestic. And that's, again, for the risk. Because if they are doing a domestic delivery, so they can at least have some certain, let's say, due diligence to know that this is not a fraud transaction. This is only a genuine transaction. But when it's come to the international, then the risk is higher. This is an old case. I don't know if you have seen it or not, but this is a very typical fraud case. Does not require any type of technology. This is a gentleman who goes to the ATM, and he is a fraudster. He went to the ATM, and he inserts sort of a ribbon into the ATM where you insert the credit card or the debit card to get the cash. And he put a little bit of that ribbon outside, but it's not visible to the person who will not concentrate on that. Then a genuine customer come in. This gentleman came in and he put his card and he want to withdraw cash. So his card will not work because there is a ribbon inside. So he put that card, he make the ribbon like he's just holding that card. So he keep trying putting the pen. Then that gentleman came again, he offer him a help. He said, what's going on? He said, no, my card is not working. He said, okay, what's your pin number? He asked him about the pen. He tried to help him, but it didn't work. Then he said, no, it's not working. So I will leave it and I will report it to the bank. That gentleman, the genuine, the card holder he left, the fraudster came back again, and he knows where to get that card. He just withdrew from the card reader. He take the ribbon out, put the card, he have the pen, and the transaction went out, and he get all the money that he want. This is no technology required in a place. But imagine, now, not only that, there are a lot of other technologies that can be used. How many times we are in a restaurant that we just hold our card to the waiters, and he take it away, and then he bring it back to us. In his way, I don't have time to show you that video right now, he take that card, and he have a scam reader. It cost him maybe less than $100. He just scan that card, take the information, and he return it back to you. Then he sell this information to these people who I show you before, and they make it. This is so popular because now the regulations that we have, either locally or internationally, are not strong enough to help us to protect the cardholder. There are rules that come from the card schemes, and there are other rules maybe built in by the countries themselves that can help. But these are still not enough to help the cardholder to protect. And I show you, I've already shown you the number of transactions and number of amount that's been as a fraud on every year. So this is sort of a statistic showing you the percentage of the cards and the fraud distribution. Lost card and stolen represent 26%, not received as an issuer or issued 2%, and the highest one is card not present, which is the online one. So we have always to be careful whenever we are introducing an e-service, we have to be very much careful with. And this is about the debit card, again showing the percentage. This is the what we call it the phishing. I'm sure the technical people or whoever on the internet knows that. It's like it's a message or an email like coming to you from Visa International telling you do this and do that and put me your PIN or card number. But at the end, it is not. It's just a fake one. It's a phishing. Unfortunately, some people believe that, and they reply and put their information, sensitive information. This is, again, the same. It says, okay, we are from Visa International. We need your card, and this is secure. Put me the card number. Put me the expiry date, and put me the CVV. And believe me, it happened. A lot of people just believe that, and they submit their information. And these are others, yeah, fake size. A lot of phishing sites, and you receive it by emails. Banks are receiving that, exactly. Mm-hmm. So what is the friendly fraud? Friendly fraud is a very simple term. Today you go to, I mean, you use transaction with around $100 or $50, and then you dispute it with the bank. You said, no, I didn't do that. It's not my transactions. Do you think the bank will bother themselves, especially if they are big banks, to keep their operation stuff and risk stuff and dispute stuff or customer just to work out on a $50? He said, okay, we will just refund it to you and that's it. So there are people who knows these tricks, and it works with some of the banks, and some of the other banks maybe it won't work, but there are people who knows that. He said, okay, I didn't do it. Although he is the one who have done that transaction, but he knows that the bank will bother themselves to go and investigate whether they he have done that transaction or not. So that's why it's called friendly fraud. Type of fraud, as I said, there is the counterfeit, which is duplicate of the full card or plastic. Then we have account number generation. I am not encouraging you to do that, but this is a tool that you easily can find it on the internet. A tool you just install it in your PC and it will generate you a numbers of credit cards. Maybe out of 10, 2 will work and the remaining 8 will not work. But it's free of charge tools, that's why the fraudsters are using it. And data compromising and leaking, which is, it happened with number of companies, especially in US, that these data was leaked out or hacked happened to their data system, and it's being used again. And this is what we said, the commerce partners. We have banks, we have merchants, and we have cardholders, and we'll see how it will work. And this is the consumer e-confidence. I will just want to move ahead. These are how it will work. We have physical access, network access, and we have the authentication and authorization. These are the things that we need to build a trusted e-commerce platform. I said about data leakage. If companies are certified in these two terms, this is not 100% guarantees, what we call it BCI and DSS, but these are mandatory right now by all of the card schemes. And even now they are mandating something called 3D, which is three domain security, 3D secure. This is just an advice for you whenever you are purchasing from an international site. If you don't see that this is a 3D secure site, it should be for Visa and MasterCard, I would not encourage you to put your credit card there, because that site is not fraud, but that site is not secure. So your card is exposed to be fraud or exposed to be taken by others, because with the 3D secure, neither the bank nor the site will be able to store your information. But without the 3D secure, the sites, the merchant side or the service provider side, will have the ability to store your information, which can be a potential for leakage. And that's the conclusion which I have already said, and thank you very much.
Շնորհակալություն, Նստաշ ջան, հայտարարում եմ փակված։
Հա, լսի։ Էս միկրոֆոնը ինչի լավ է, չէ՞։ Այդ միկրոֆոնի հետ դու գործ չունեք, չէ՞, երեխե։ Այդ միկրոֆոնների հետ։ Էս վերջինս մանեց սուղակի։ Էս մարդը որ խոսում էր,
Այսինքն
արդեն ես գրքի կերջում դրեմ, որտև արդեն կա առաջ։ էթնոգրաֆիան ժամանակով հայկա ասում էր, չի լսում, չի լսում, բարձր ժամանակ ոչ մի խնդիր չկա, այդ ժամանակ ոչ մի խնդիր, չի մարդու հետ նվար,
հա, բար վերջացրին
ապես, կամ նստել էր, կամ էր, որ մյուսը վերցեց են քանմատիկ էր
պահենք, լավ, եկանք, եկանք,
մեկ էլ են պահ,
հա,
ուսեր եմ, որ խոսում էր, ինքը մեկ մոտեցնել, մեկ հեռացնել,